Hello friends, today we are going to discuss about assessment in psychiatry. Basically, we are going to discuss about evaluation in mental disorder. I am Dr. Suresh Padmat, Professor of Psychiatry, Head of Telemedicine Center, Head of Forensic Psychiatry Unit at NIMHANS, Bangalore. In this video, we will discuss about what is psychiatry, what are the challenges in assessment, and how the history taking is done. The people who are going to benefit by these videos are undergraduates, postgraduates working in the area of mental health, basically junior residents and also practitioners working in the mental health, primary care doctors, nurses, psychologists and psychiatric social workers, nurses, family members with persons with mental illness and also persons with mental illness will benefit by watching this video. This video will also say how the evaluation is done so that they are prepared for the evaluation. Let's understand about psychiatry. Psychiatry is a branch of medicine. It deals with pathology of the brain and also it deals with abnormal cognitions, abnormal emotions and also abnormal behavior. It is basically deals with prevention, diagnosis and management of psychiatric illness. This is the best way of explaining psychiatry, but unfortunately, the psychiatry is faced with many challenges. For example, the psychiatry cannot be diagnosed by any lab tests, such as there is no blood test to diagnose a psychiatric illness. There is no X-ray, CT scan, or MRI which positively will diagnose psychiatric illness. There is no genetic test which will positively say, yes, this person is suffering from mental illness. That means there are no tests available for diagnosis of psychiatry. That means the whole assessment revolves around good clinical examination. So this is one of the biggest challenge in the area of psychiatry and also mental illness. Let's understand. The psychiatry also is basically many of the doctors will talk about psychopathology. Unfortunately, the psychopathology is a word which has been used since long duration. But unfortunately, it is a pathology of the brain functioning. That means there is some abnormality in the functioning of the brain. So what are the functions of the brain? One is cognitions, that is perception, storing, analyzing, reasoning and utilizing the available information. Emotions, how we feel, how we react to a situation, and also behavior. So these are the important three functions of the brain. So any pathology in these function, pathology in the cognition, pathology in the emotions, pathology in the behavior, we call it as psychiatry. Unfortunately, it has been called as psychopathology. There is nothing called as psychopathology. It is basically abnormality in the functioning of the brain. Abnormality in the perception. That is hallucination we call it as. Or else illusions or pseudo-hallucinations. There is problem in the memory. We call it as amnesia. The problem in thinking process. We call it as delusions, overvalued ideas. Similarly, abnormality in the emotions. We call it as depression, mania, anger, and similarly, we also talk about violence, that is behavioral abnormality. So, the whole process of psychiatry revolves around these psychopathologies, so-called psychopathology, but it's basically the pathology in the functioning of the brain. So, let's understand what are the different types of psychiatric assessment. First and the foremost is screening, detailed evaluation, and follow-up assessment. Depending upon the type of assessment, the duration is usually taken. For a screening, usually it is done at the first contact. It will be between 5 to 10 minutes. Basically, the screening is done to know what is the diagnosis. That is basically provisional diagnosis, whether the person requires immediate admission or else immediate intensive care unit care or else OPD basis treatment. So it's usually done in the first contact, as I mentioned. Detailed evaluation is usually done to know the diagnosis, to know the management, to plan for rehabilitation. But it is depending upon the individual experience or professional discretion, it may last for 15 to 45 minutes. A good psychiatrist who have been working for many years can do the diagnosis within 15 minutes. A young psychiatrist or a student may take 45 minutes. So it is depending upon the professional experience, wisdom, on that basis the time is taken. The follow-up is also basically when the patient has been diagnosed, when he is coming for follow-up, the time taken may be 5 to 10 minutes. Again, it is depending upon the clinical situation also. These are all the approximate time. It is not fixed time. It is an approximate time I am talking about. This is about the different types of history taking, the time taken. Collating information. See, as I mentioned, the psychiatry do not have any lab tests. So, we have to collect information from the patient, family members of the patient, friends, relatives. If the patient is working, you can contact the employees with the consent of the patient. If the patient is referred from the police or a forensic, collect the information from the police and other agencies. So collecting information from various sources will give accuracy in diagnosis. And mental status examination, cognitive function, ward observations, and some psychological test will yield a very good diagnosis. Let's understand about detailed evaluation. Today we are not going to discuss about screening and follow-up. We will focus on the detailed evaluation. So detailed evaluation has 15 steps. The 15 steps are, first and the foremost is demographic details, that is identification data, chief complaints, history of presenting illness, negative history, medical history, past history, family history, personal history, premorbid personality, general physical examination, mental status examination, cognitive function, summary, formulation, and diagnosis. These are the 15 different steps used in the assessment of psychiatry. First, we will take about the demographic details. The demographic details is basically name. Whenever you take for the name, you should call the patient by the name. That will help the patient to feel comfort, and also he knows the doctor is talking to me. That is basically the patient. And also, if possible, ask for photo ID, especially Aadhaar card or any photo ID, because if you are going to do telemedicine in future, this assessment can be a identification, and also in the future, whenever you are going to do telemedicine, you can ask for the same ID which he had produced during the first consultation or in-person consultation. So the age, gender, occupation, socioeconomic status, from which kind of economic status he is coming from, marital status, address, and mobile number. These are required if you are going to do telemedicine, and also these are the identification data to know whenever you are issuing the certificate. And also you need to gather information from multiple sources. The more the informant, the best will be the credibility of the information. So if it is a neurotic, the patient alone is enough. But however, if you are looking for a personality disorder, it's worthwhile asking for family members and friends, even if it is a neurotic condition. Psychotic condition, of course, you have to interview the patient along with the family members and others to come to a good information source, then only you'll be able to make a diagnosis. At the same time, whenever you are taking the informants, please to name the informant, ask for the relationship, duration of the being acquaintance with the patient. If he's a family member, it's well and good. Many a time the family member would have launched out of the family and he may not be in contact with the patient. So the duration of contact and the duration of knowing the patient history has to be clearly documented. Information provided should be reliable and adequate. The reliable and adequacy is based upon diagnosis, management planning, and rehabilitation. So if you are able to do that, then only we will call it as reliable and adequate. So reliable and adequate are measured by 6 C's and 3 A's. 6 C's basically clarity of the information, credibility of the information. The same information provided by one family member and also other family member is credible. That means by cross-verifying from one person to another person, the same information you are going to get. Coherence, that basically the whole story provided with regard to the patient illness is coherently present. Consistent, consistent from the today they have given the history, and if you ask after 2 days, the same history you are going to get. Even after fifth day or over a period of time, the same, consistently the same history is getting. Continuity of information. If the patient has 5 years history, you are able to get the 5 years history continuously, then continuity of information is there. Adequate for diagnosis, accuracy and appropriateness also plays an important role in getting the information. If you have any information lacking, please do document saying that the family members are not present, or the family member who is present is missing since past 1 year, hence the information provided is inadequate. Based upon that, we are making a provisional diagnosis. So the information provided should be documented, the name of the informant should be documented, and the duration and acquittance should be clearly documented. Now let's move into the chief complaints. The chief complaints should be in the patient's own words. And how to ask that? Ask the patient, what brings you here? How can I help you? Such questions, if you ask them, they only will start talking, and you will be able to document that. Please document in patient's own words. Don't use technical words. And also, it should be presented in the chronological order. Start from the first symptom which has started. That means the first symptom onwards to the last symptom, you have to chronologically, you have to maintain. Duration of each symptoms. And also, don't write a huge list of complaints. Try to prioritize. And again, this will be possible only if you are working for 4 to 5 years, then you'll be able to prioritize which are the symptoms which are worth for a diagnosis. And also, silent complaint should be documented. And also, patient family members can provide what are the other chief complaints, and also reason for consultation can be documented here. Many a time, the family members or the patient may report to you for just for the certificate. Please do document the reason for consultation is for disability certificate or else insanity defense certificate. So the reason for consultation can also be documented here. And onset. This is a very, very important prognostic factor. That is basically, if you take the duration on the x-axis and the severity of illness on the y-axis, and this is the onset of symptoms, and the symptoms are slowly picking up and has increased to a maximum. And this is the condition where the diagnosable, so from the onset of illness to the diagnosable condition, it is called as onset. So the time taken or the duration from the first onset of symptom to a diagnosable condition, we call it as onset. This is very essential, because if it is an abrupt onset, that means within 2 days of the onset of illness, the patient, we can make a diagnosis. Within 2 days, he has having a clearly diagnosable condition. It is called as abrupt onset. It has an excellent prognosis. Acute onset. From the onset of first symptom to diagnosable condition, if it is within 2 weeks, we call it as acute onset. This also has a good prognosis. Subacute onset, between 2 weeks to months. So then it will be the onset of symptom to the diagnosable condition, it takes months. Insidious onset, it is a very slowly the behavioral patterns changed over a period of time. Family members may not be able to pinpoint when it started exactly. They may say it started around 2 years back and the first abnormal symptom was seen, and then after 6 months they saw another abnormal symptom, and over a period of time they have said insidious onset. This has a poor prognosis. So that means onset has a very good prognostic indicator till date. And also, talk about the course. What is the course of the illness? The course, if you again take the duration, severity of illness, the course, how the progression of the illness is occurring, that is called as course. There are three different, roughly the course can be considered. One is episodic, that is there is a first, if you look at the first chart, there is one episode and the second episode. In between the two episodes, the person is completely all right. The whole red mark is considered as an episode. The chronic, the illness has started, the treatment has been started, but however, he has never remitted, he never came to the baseline. That is chronic condition. The third one is chronic with fluctuation or frequent exacerbation of symptoms. That is in the third. That means the person has chronic illness with frequent, the symptoms gets worsened. And also document about the precipitating factors. Is there any temporal correlation between the stressor and the onset of symptoms? And also documenting the triggering event is very essential. Was there a marital discord? Was there a relationship failure? Or else loss of job, death of a loved ones? All those things, again, presence of a precipitating factor also has a prognostic indicator. Now let's move on to the history of presenting illness. So history of presenting illness, you have to present the symptom in the chronological order. The first chief complaint, you have to take it and explain it. That is, describe each symptom, quantify and qualify each symptom. That means every person on this earth would have felt sad once or one or the other time in the life. That doesn't mean they're suffering from depression. The person who is suffering from depression means the qualitatively and quantitatively, his depression is very severe. That means duration may be long, the severity of depression will be long. So that means you have to quantify and qualify each symptom. So how to do that? There is a simple way of quantifying and qualifying symptom. Start with duration, under what context it started. Is it only within the family members or it in the workplace or else in the social situation? What is the frequency of the symptom? Is it increasing factors? Is there any aggravating factor, any relieving factor or decreasing factor? How the progression of the symptoms? In the past 1 month, how the symptom is there? What is the outcome of this symptom? You have to give a good explanation of this symptom. Each symptom, what you mentioned in the chief complaint, needs to be described in history of presenting illness. It is nothing like, it is simply equivalent to a medical history, the way you take. For example, how to explain each symptom? Just if you are going to take a history of fever, how do you take a history of fever in any medical condition? Duration, you may say the person is suffering from 2 weeks of fever, and the context, this fever started when he was traveling, and when he came back home, he had a mild fever, and this fever started increasing, very high fever, maybe one or two degrees centigrade, and it is every 2 days, it's very high. It is associated with chills and rigors, and it decreases by taking medication and rest. And in the past 1 month, it has been becoming very severe. And also, you have to mention, because of the symptom, he is unable to go to work. So this is how you are going to explain the symptom. If I am going to give an explanation of a psychiatric symptom, let's quantify and qualify physical abuse. This is the commonest symptom which is presented in psychiatry. So duration of physical abuse is 3 months. It is present not only within the family context. He has been becoming physically abusive even in the workplace. He has beaten up two of his colleagues, and also he has beaten up unknown people in the society also. It is almost present every hour. Within every few hours, he will assault any person who is nearby him. The aggravating factor or increasing factors are those whenever they challenge his thinking process. Whenever he stops him by doing certain activities, whenever somebody questions his authority, he becomes extremely violent. Decreasing or what we call it as relieving factors is whenever he is left alone, whenever he is sleeping, he does not become violent. Progression of symptoms. In the past 1 month, the symptoms is increasing. It is earlier, it was maybe once or twice a day. Now it has become almost every hour he is becoming violent. And outcome of the symptoms, in the past 3 months, he had been arrested twice, but has been given warning and sent back home. So that means it required legal intervention, or else the public or the family members or society had reported his problems with the police. And also inquire other essential symptoms. These are all, inquire about the risk to self, that is suicidal ideas, or else deliberate self-harm. Risk to others, violence towards others, homicidal ideas towards others. So these risks to others, both these and also unable to take care of himself. All these three important factors will indicate the requirement for admission. That is under Mental Health Care Act of Section 89, he may require immediate admission. So please do assess for this important condition. And also, the emergency requirement of treatment will be indicated by these three essential important symptoms. Again, I will repeat: dangerous to self, dangerous to others, unable to take care of himself. These are the three important criteria for admission and immediate management. Associated function also need to be asked. First and the foremost is biological function. The biological function is sleep, diet, libido, that is basically sex, hygiene, whether he is able to take bath daily, bowel and bladder habits. So these needs to be explained, because this will give a good information how much his biological function is disturbed because of his psychiatric illness. Occupational functioning, whether he is able to go to work daily, how often he is not going to work, attention and concentration in work. Is there any inquiry pending against him because of his abnormal behavior, and his functioning to be documented here. Social functioning. This is basically interaction with friends, family, neighbors and others people. How is his behavior with them? And please do document a typical day. How the patient, at what time he gets up, how he goes to take bath, bowel and bladder habits, breakfast, and his behavior as a whole day needs to be documented. Check for any legal, financial and family issues because of psychiatric illness. This should be a fair history taking for history of presenting illness. At the same time, if the illness is for more than 2 to 3 years or 4 years, please do the life charting. Life charting is basically how the symptoms started and how often the symptoms are present, for how much duration, and over a period of, on the x-axis you are going to see there is years have been clearly measured there, and also you can see the episodes. That the x mark is the treatment chart, treatment, how long the person has taken the treatment, and in the below the x-axis you are going to talk about the symptoms in each episode, duration of each symptom, whether the person required admission or outpatient treatment, and life events. If was there any precipitating event or any life event has to be noted. And also please do document the reason for relapse on each episode. And also, if you are going to chart for a psychotic disorder, this is how it looks. And also, usually it will be shaded black. That is the way you are going to document for life charting in psychotic disorder. If it is a mood disorder, in mania, it is the half semicircle which will be presented above the line on x-axis. This is two manic episodes. And the depression, that is the inverted semicircle which will be presented, mentioning the normal mood disorder, the normal mood, and also the mania is the higher one, and the lower one will be the depression. This is how the life charting is done. Let's move into the negative history. Once you have finished the history of presenting illness with life charting, we will take negative history. Negative history is basically to, if the patient has not reported certain symptoms, it is the duty of the doctor or the psychologist or the social worker to ask for certain history, whether they are there or not. For example, organicity. Was there any head injury? Was there any fever? Vomiting? So these, whether there is a temporal correlation between these organicity events and the onset of psychiatric illness. So that, if it is there, please do say it is there. If it is not there, you have to say there was no organicity present. Any chronic medical illness, if it is there, please do ask for it and document it. If it is not there, please say that there is no any chronic medical conditions. Is there any history of substance use like alcohol, opioid, cannabis, any other drugs? Ask for it. If it is not there, mention that there is no history of substance abuse. If it is present, please do document in the history of presenting illness. Ask for various other psychotic experiences. Ask for mood symptoms like mania symptoms, depression, and anxiety symptoms. With the negative history, we now move to medical history. This is very essential because many a time the medical history becomes a challenge in managing the psychiatric illness. So please ask for any past or present medical illness. If it is there, any medication he is taking or he has taken in the past or he is going to plan to take it in future. And document about the chronic medical conditions like hypertension, diabetes, liver failure or renal failure or any abnormality, or else he had any hypersensitivity for any medication or allergic reaction to any medication, please do document here. Moving to the past history, this is again, it becomes very essential to know whether the person had any past history of psychiatric illness. If he had, how many number of episodes he had, what are the treatment he had taken, which psychiatrist he has visited, which nursing home he had visited, how many inpatient care, whether he required ECT or injections, treatment history, side effect of any medication, response to treatment and duration of treatment. All these need to be documented in past history. If the past history it is there, if there is between two episodes, when do we consider it as past history? For that, I am giving an explanation. If between the two episodes, that is the inter-episode period, if the person achieves premorbid level of functioning, like before the illness, whatever the functioning is there, he achieves full remission for a period of more than 2 months, we call it as a new episode. That means between the two episode, 2 months of normalcy is required. Then only we call it as new episode. In this scenario, the last one will be presented in the HOPI and the remaining, the initial two episode will be presented in the past history. This is how you are going to document, especially in past history. So please remember, 2 months of normalcy or 2 months of achieving baseline premorbid level of functioning, if it is achieved, then only we will call it as past history. This will be presented in past history, these two episodes, and this will be presented in history of presenting illness. Let's now move into family history. This is very essential because the persons with mental illness invariably in India are being taken care by the family members. So please do 3-generation genogram or pedigree charting, we call it as, history of any medical illness or psychiatric disorder in family members. What is the living arrangement? Who is the primary caregiver? Because we have to do the psychoeducation to them and also tell them how to supervise the medication, how often they should bring them for follow-up, how to expect the remission occurs and the rehabilitation. At the same time, you should know who is the leader, who is going to take the decision in the family, so that any change in medication, the cost of medication, starting a ECT or doing any rehabilitation, job related or marriage related issues to be discussed with this leader of the family. What is the type of communication? And also please do assess roughly what is the family understanding about the illness. Same time, what is the family member's attitude towards the patient? That is basically expressed emotion. And also, is there any family stressors and family discord to be noted here? If you look at this, these are the genogram symbols which you should know. So the females are represented by a circle. The square is represented by him. The square is usually represented for male. And the shaded male is affected family male member. Shaded circle will be considered as affected female member. If a square connected to a circle is considered as consanguineous marriage. If there is an arrow mark next to either a circle or a square, it is called as indexed patient. The normal marriage, non-consanguineous marriage, will be a connection between the square and the circle, will be considered as a marriage. Abortion is usually presented by a triangle. And if there is a death, there is a slash mark will be written against the circle or the square. This is what is called as 3-generation genogram. In this 3-generation genogram, you can see the patient is a 18-year-old lady or a girl, and a 24-year elder brother is there. This is the, you can call it as the 3rd generation. That is basically the current generation. Father and mother. And mother is the only daughter, And here the father is the last son of three siblings. That is basically he has elder brother and younger sister. We can call it as a second generation. The first generation is grandparents, paternal grandparents and the maternal grandparents. This is how you are going to present the genogram. If there is a history of depression in the grandfather, if you can see, paternal grandfather has history of depression. That is also shaded blue. And the patient, index patient, a female patient, 18-year-old, also has depression. Similarly, the maternal grandmother has dementia. It has been marked by yellow. So this is how you are going to represent the genogram. And this genogram needs to be documented in every psychiatric detailed evaluation. It is not required in screening, but in detailed evaluation, of course, it is required. Now moving towards the personal history. This is personal history of the persons with mental illness. Personal history starts with birth and early development. Basically, how the birth took place, what was the antenatal care, what was the care during the delivery, was there any problem during delivery, was there a cesarean section, was there any obstruction, was there any difficulty in the child Apgar score. If you are able to get it, is excellent. And whether the child cried immediately, the type of delivery need to be documented here. At the same time, whether the milestones development was normal or delayed needs to be documented. Very often in the Indian scenario, the mother may not remember at what age the child was able to walk or able to speak. It is very easy to ask them whether your child, compared to your other children, whether you are slow in walking, speaking, having food on his own, bladder control. If you ask that, the mother will be easily able to compare between the children, or else between her child and the neighbor's child. She will say, yes, it was normal, or else she may clearly say that, yes, my child had around 3 months to 6 months delayed in talking or speaking, walking, she's able to give. So that comparative information should be asked. Behavior during the childhood, whether the child was easygoing, whether child had frequent temper tantrums, whether the child had any other issues need to be documented here. Childhood illness, whether the child used to have any respiratory infection, any physical illness or any mental illness need to be documented. What was the schooling? How the schooling was done? Whether he was average at study or whether very difficulty in picking up academics? The college, how did he face the difficulties? If he had occupation, if he was able to hold a job, what kind of occupation? How long he was able to hold the job? Whether he was frequently changing the job, what was the reason for changing the job? That needs to be documented. Menstrual history, attainment of menarche, especially in women, the last menstrual cycle, whether it is regular, irregular, needs to be documented. If the person is actively in sexual, need to take the history of sexual history. But however, whenever you're taking sexual history, please be very, very discreet. Ask these information when the patient is alone. And when you ask this information, you can also need to give an option. They are free to refuse to answer with regard to personal details about sexual history. The person says, I do not want to discuss this issue. Please do not probe. You say that the patient did not want to discuss about sexual history. So please be very, very sensitive when you are asking about sexual history. So if the patient does not want to discuss, do not probe further. Marital history, that is marriage, how the marriage occurred, all those things can be discussed here. Here, again, I'm pointing out the marital history is the family of procreation. The family history which we had discussed was family of origin. Here, what is the marital? The bonding, if it is a marriage has occurred, what is the bonding? At the same time, nowadays, living relationship is becoming very common. If there is a living relationship is there in the marital history, or else living relation history can be documented here. And if you are able to get that living in partner history, would be wonderful. Substance use, history of any substance use need to be documented in personal history. Now let's move on to premorbid personality. So premorbid personality is basically what was the personality of the person before the onset of illness. That is, prior to mental illness, what was the personality? How to ask this? Ask the patient to describe himself, and also ask the family members, how do you describe your son or daughter who is having mental illness, that is before the onset of illness, and ask them to compare with other family members or else with the neighbors, how, whether the person was outgoing, extrovert, introvert, whether he was very social, whether he was taking responsible, whether he was good at academics. These are the issues need to be asked. And also ask the patient, what do your friends and family members perceive about you? And also try to collect multiple information from family members, friends, relatives. When you take the information, ask for examples. Anecdotes of examples should be asked. If the family members say, he is shy, can you give me an example? What is the reason you are telling he is shy? They may give a good example. Document that. And those examples are very, very essential. And also, attempt should be made to explain the person what is the kind of personality, why we are asking this information. Premorbid personality is assessed on these 11 important points. Social relations. How the patient was maintaining social relations. Premorbid functioning. Whether he was able to take up the responsibility, whether he was able to do functioning almost daily. So those premorbid functioning needs to be taken up. Taking up responsibility, whether he was very open to take up responsibility, avoiding responsibility, those needs to be documented here. Coping with stress, what was the mechanism of his coping, whether he was taking alcohol, and under stress he used to become violent, that needs to be documented. Intellectual activities, hobbies, mood, whether it was mood was irritable, stable, or depressive mood, that needs to be documented. Character is very essential. Attitude to work, interpersonal relationship comes under the character. Energy and initiative with regard to any activity, fantasy life and habit. Again, in the fantasy life, when you are asking, be discreet and ask the patient when he is alone about the fantasy life. If the patient is able to give the information, it's well and good. If he doesn't want to discuss that, do not force the patient to talk about his fantasy life, because these are all very personal to the patient. Now let's go into the general physical examination. General physical examination is done by only doctors, that is registered medical practitioners. Neither the psychologist, social worker should not do. However, nurses can do certain part of general physical examination, like vitals, pulse, BP, temperature, height, weight can be done. Lymph nodes examination, thyroid examination, retinal examination, respiratory system examination, central nervous system, cerebrovascular, cardiovascular system, per abdomen. This is the general physical examination needs to be done and to be documented in all detailed evaluation. Now let's move into the very important aspect of mental status examination. Mental status examination, although I am presenting, is here brief. I'm going to make a separate video about the detailed mental status examination. Let's look into the mental status examination. Mental status examination starts with general appearance and behavior. Basically, how the patient comes into your room, what is his dress, how is he behaving, whether the eye contact is maintained, whether the rapport was able to be established, whether the patient had any abnormal movements. Those things has to be explained in general appearance and behavior. That is basically, without talking to the patient, what the doctor felt about the patient, how he came, how he sat, how the rapport was built, that general appearance and behavior needs to be documented here. Psychomotor activity, whether the activity of the patient with regard to goal directed, whether it is increased, decreased, or else the patient is restless, he's moving, just pacing up and down in the room, then you have to mention restlessness. There is no goal directed, just pacing up and down. So goal directed activity is increased or decreased, or restlessness, that needs to be documented under psychomotor activity. Speech, whether the speech, when you want to get the speech, ask for a speech sample. How to get the speech sample? It is simple. Ask the patient to describe any festival. Maybe please explain about Deepavali. Please explain how do you celebrate Ramzan or Christmas. So ask him why it is celebrated, how it is celebrated. Ask him how recently the past Deepavali, how did he celebrate? How did he do on that day, next day? And what was the celebration? How did he feel? So the free sample, this question should be open-ended question so that the patient can speak very openly and also with his own thinking process, he will give a good sample. You can also ask him about his family, explain who are there in the family. And also you can ask, tell me about your place. If the patient says, I am from Goa, ask him about the Goa. What is the place? How is the place? And what is it famous for? All those openly you can ask open question, open-ended question should be asked for speech sample. Once you get a good speech sample, write out verbatim about this sample. Many a time you may not be able to write the whole verbatim because the patient may be speaking very fast. In such a scenario, you can record it on your mobile phone about the question you had asked and how the patient answered. Based upon that speech sample, you are going to comment whether it was coherent, whether it was relevant to the question asked, what was the tone of the patient, tempo of his speech, reaction time, and the volume of his speech. So these are the three important points you are going to ask for mental status examination. Further, you will ask for thought. What was the thought process? In that, you will talk about form of the thought, where you will comment about formal thought disorder. Stream. How the flow of thought is there. Whether the flow of thought is fast or slow, that will be commented here. Possession. Who is the owner of this thought? Here it will be discussed. Basically, obsessions you are going to talk about, and thought alienation phenomena will be discussed here in the possession. Content. It is the delusions, overvalued ideas, depressive cognitions, preoccupations, suicidal ideas, and death wishes will be documented under content. Moving to the mood, here you are going to talk about whether the person is depressed, whether the person is happy. You ask about subjectively, how are you feeling since past 1 month or past 1 week, and objectively comment how he looks and whether his thought and mood is congruent, whether his thought process and the mood are congruent to each other, is the congruency appropriate to the situation, whether his mood is appropriate to the situation. Range and reactivity and lability of the mood needs to be commented here. Perception. Here you will be talking about hallucinations, pseudo-hallucination and delusions will be commented at here. The hallucination will be from any special senses. It may be hearing, auditory hallucination, seeing, visual hallucination, tactile hallucination, gustatory hallucination, olfactory hallucination. So these are the various hallucinations you are going to document under perception. Other phenomena like somatic passivity, depersonalization, derealization, here the other phenomena you are going to comment. So these are the important mental status examination components. With this, we will move into cognitive function. Cognitive function starts with consciousness. Whether the person is conscious, whether it is alert, whether it is drowsy, stuporous, or comatose condition. So that you are going to talk about consciousness. If he is conscious, he will continue with the assessment. Whether he is oriented to time, place, and person. For time, you will ask, what is the time? What is the time? What is the day today? What is the year? What is the week? Which is this place? Who is the person standing next to you? Who is this person? So all those will be commented here. Attention and concentration. Attention and concentration will be assessed based on digit forward and digit backward. Serial subtraction will be used for attention and concentration. So once the attention and concentration is normal, then only you will do further examination. If the attention and concentration is very bad, further assessment is not useful, because the patient is, if he is unable to hold attention and concentration, any assessment becomes useless. If the attention and concentration is sustainable, you will do memory assessment. Immediate memory, recent memory, remote memory you will going to assess. Immediate memory is digit forward and digit backward is more than for immediate memory. For the recent memory, ask him about what did he have yesterday night or day before yesterday night, the events which had passed in the past 1 week. you can ask him. So the family members you have to corroborate those information. At the same time, you can also give address test or 5-object test. You ask him to repeat it, and after 5 minutes, distract him, and after 5 minutes, request to remember them. So that is the recent. Remote is the past events, it may be life events or maybe non-personal events. Maybe who was the prime minister in 2000, or else who was the father of our nation? When you were born, where you were born, who was the name, the school where you studied? Those are all becomes the remote history, remote memory. Intelligence. So again, you should ask for general fund of information. You can ask for 5 personalities, 5 rivers, 5 festivals, and also who is the political leader, who is the party. Those kind of information you can ask. If he is illiterate, you can ask for maybe if he is a farmer, you can ask him about the agricultural yield, how it is grown. Those are the information. Comprehension, arithmetic, maybe simple calculation, subtraction, those kind of there can be asked here. Abstraction, basically similarities, difference, and proverb will be assessed here. Judgment will be assessed on personal information, social judgment, and test judgment. I will be dealing with them separately in a separate video. Insight, whether the person is aware about his illness, what is the attribution for his illness, whether he is accepting for treatment. You can tell that insight is present, absent, or partial based upon the 3 important A's: awareness, attribution, and acceptance. Coming to the last part, that is summary. Summary is nothing but providing the brief or concise information of the whole history. It is basically you are going to give the facts in a brief, because the whole presentation may be around 5 to 6 pages. Summary will be around 1.5 page, will be the only facts will be written there. And it is, the purpose is to enable others who are unfamiliar with the patient to grasp the essential feature of the patient's problem. And summary should be presented the way the detailed evaluation is done, but it in a very brief. That is about the summary. Moving to the diagnostic formulation. Formulation is very essential. This is an analytical process of the doctor's assessment of the patient. What are the signs and symptoms he had seen? And he has to make a what are those symptoms and his evaluation, and what are those symptoms and the signs which will yield to the diagnosis. He will use all technical terms here. Plan of management will be done here. Significant findings in the history, personal history, family history, past history, premorbid history, general physical examination, MSE, and cognitive function. Only significant findings, so technical terms will be used here. The doctor who is presenting the diagnostic formulation should also plan for the prognosticating the condition, and also the management and rehabilitation should be said here in the diagnostic formulation. And also, please do remember, the treatment history, even if there are investigation done, should be documented here. Point in favor of the diagnosis, point against the diagnosis need to be discussed in the diagnostic formulation. And if the person is unable to come to any diagnosis, differential diagnosis should be given in the diagnostic formulation. And as I mentioned, prognostic factors need to be discussed here. Finally, the diagnosis. If you are able to arrive at a diagnosis, it's fine. If you are not, the provisional diagnosis. The most likely diagnosis can be documented here. That is provisional diagnosis. And you have to mention this is a provisional diagnosis because the information is less, or the patient is in the prodrome symptom. The illness is not fully formed. Then the provisional diagnosis will keep. Differential diagnosis. You are examining the patient and you are getting various information and you are unable to pinpoint the diagnosis. Then you will make a differential diagnosis. That means list of possible diagnosis. Confirmatory diagnosis. Based upon your observation, based upon the history, based upon investigation, you are making a confirmatory diagnosis. And my dear friends, this is how the 15 steps of detailed evaluation in psychiatry is done, from demographic detail to diagnosis. Okay, if you like this video, please do subscribe. and stay safe.